Earlier this month, the subscriber count for this channel, Atomic Shrimp, passed 750,000. 750,000. This is just really incredible, and I'm so very grateful for every one of you who's subscribed. At past subscriber milestones, I've celebrated by making play buttons out of various different materials. This time, I wanted to make something a little bit more useful, although at the same time sort of preposterously useless. So please join me as I attempt to make the physical embodiment of the concept of three quarters. I want to make this video the most three-quarteriest video anyone has ever made. So, using everyone's favourite graphical design tool, Microsoft PowerPoint, I created a template for three quarters of a circle. Then I added three smaller circles, each of which will contribute approximately one quarter of its circumference to create rounded corners. I printed this and stuck it down onto a piece of plywood, then cut it out using a jigsaw. I tried to stay right on the line, as I will need both the part that I'm cutting out and the panel from which it's cut. I cut a couple of pieces like this and glued them together just because the original plywood isn't thick enough for what I think I need to make. I find that a jigsaw, you might call this a scroll saw, often doesn't cut a properly vertical kerf, no matter if I go really slowly or use a brand new sharp blade. So I use the trim bit on the router just to neaten this up a little bit. I also rounded over the edge of the ply to create a smoothly curved edge, then I used an abrasive flap wheel just to sand off all the rough parts, and for a little bit of finished shaping where I'd wobbled off course when I was cutting. I glued the cutout piece to another panel of plywood, using the pieces with the holes as a guide for keeping everything in registration. When the glue was set, I gave the parts a generous coat of paste wax. This is mainly to act as a sort of lubricant for the process that's coming up in a moment. I took a piece of 1mm aluminium sheet and marked it out, then cut it. I need it to be bigger than the hole in the board by a margin all the way around. I heated it with a blowtorch just to try to anneal it a little bit. I'm not actually sure I got it hot enough to make a difference, but oh well. Then all of these parts I assembled into my press. This is actually a press that I built a few years back for pressing apples to make cider, but it'll hopefully work for other purposes. Again, another liberal application of wax, and away we go. These couple of extra pieces of plywood will hopefully constrain the metal from just upending into the cavity as I press it. I am expecting that the metal will pucker a bit and gather as it's pressed, but these pieces here will help to control that somewhat. So first pressing, and this is only a 1-ton hydraulic jack, but it did manage to drive the press closed a little bit. Let's have a look at the result. A bit messy. I heated it up again just to try to anneal some of the bits that most need to move, and then I returned it to the press, this time without the additional plywood layer, for a deeper pressing. The end result, not especially pretty, but probably the best we can hope for with these tools and methods. I can work with this. There are some places where the metal has pleated, but they're fairly unobtrusive, and I'm not going to get a better result of that with this method, so I'm just going to tap these pleats flat a little bit. Using the original wooden form, I tapped it closer to the desired shape. Then using a chisel, I trimmed off the edges. A chisel's not exactly the right tool here, but this is an old one. Now that the flange is removed, I can shape it a bit more, without the material on the edge constraining further bending. But there's still a really horrible jagged edge on there. So again, the flap wheel sander. Now this is not really the right tool for this job because it can just grab thin material like this. So I went with great care and I didn't press too hard. And I finished with an abrasive sheet on a flat board. A little bit more shaping and flattening of bumps and dents, and a really good scrub and rinse, and there it is, 3/4 of a pan. Perfect for all of those times you want to make 3/4 of a pie. I made a sweet shortcrust pastry, 300 grams of flour, 3 quarters white to 1 quarter wholemeal, 200 grams of butter, 3 quarters unsalted to 1 quarter salted. Blend the butter into the flour, 50 grams of sugar and a tiny bit of almond essence. Then add a beaten egg plus a small amount of cold water. The water's not dirty, by the way, it's the same cup that I cracked the egg in. I just did that so that it would rinse out the last bits of egg and they wouldn't go to waste. When it comes together into a ball of dough, that's enough water, and it only takes a few tablespoons of water for this. Then cover it and chill it in the fridge for half an hour. Meanwhile, I buttered the pan and then coated the butter with semolina. This will help the crust to release from the pan. I rolled out one half of the dough and lined the tin. And I just lift up the edges here and let them fall into place rather than pushing and stretching them down into the corners. And then a little trim, and we're not going to waste those trimmings. Then a big Bramley apple, peeled and sliced fairly thin. Grams of sugar mixed with about a teaspoon each of cinnamon and ground mace. Sorry about the focus here, I don't know what happened. You could use other spices here, such as nutmeg or cloves or anything else you like. Then the apple slices go in there in layers, each layer sprinkled with some of that spiced sugar. No particular measurements here, I'm just doing what looks about right. Second half of the dough is rolled out and goes on top. Then another little trim and a crimp all the way around. And back into the fridge to chill before baking. Those trimmings of pastry aren't going to go to waste, so each time dough is rolled and re-rolled, it can get a little bit tougher when it's finally baked. But that won't be a problem for jam tarts. So I roll it out, cut some circles, into the tart tin, rolled out the trimmings again and cut them and into the tart tin, and so on, repeating this cycle until there's almost nothing left. Then a teaspoon of jam in each one. Lovely plum jam I bought at a local craft sale. No more than a teaspoon or else it'll boil over during baking. To glaze the pie, I separated an egg and just used the yolk, brushing it on, then sprinkling on a little bit more of that spiced sugar. Baked at 180 Celsius for 40 minutes. Near the end of baking, I brushed it with some of the egg white and then more sugar. So yolk for golden colour, white for shine. The jam tarts only need half of that time, and when they come out, the jam will be like fruity napalm, so always wait at least 20 minutes before biting into them. And there it is, 3/4 or thereabouts of an apple pie. But we're not done yet. Now I want to transform the 3/4 baking pan into a 3/4 frying pan. So, here we go. I made some paper templates based on the shape of the existing pan, and then I transferred these to sheet metal, 3mm aluminium for the handle, which I cut out with a jigsaw. Then finished with a file and sandpaper. An additional section needs a lattice of holes, so I just printed a pattern and stuck it on, making sure I wasn't going to drill too close to the edge. I drilled all the holes with a 3mm drill bit, which took forever. Then I enlarged them with a bigger drill, which was easier because it just sort of lines itself up. This left a big mess of burrs, which I just sanded off. Then I clamped the pieces in a vise and bent the tabs into shape. So the lattice piece will sort of clip onto the top edge of the pan. The Y-shaped piece will bolt underneath it and will be bent so as to fit around the bottom of the pan. We'll have a close look at this right at the end of the video. a little bit of cleaning up with some fine steel wool, then I washed everything really thoroughly, and the next day got ready to go out foraging and cooking. I made some custard to go with that apple pie, 3/4 of a pint of custard. I've made it really thick and it will set a bit in this box, and that's fine with me. I'll also need some ingredients for cooking, including this lovely cheddar cheese. I only need a sort of little chunk, so 3/4 of it can go back in the fridge for another time. Now, off into the forest for some foraging. We were lucky enough to find some lovely hedgehog mushrooms, as well as some trumpet chanterelles or yellow legs. And these are two choice species, and indeed two of my very favourites for cooking, as well as one little yellow chanterelle and a few amethyst deceivers. So, with about 3/4 of a basket of mushrooms, we were ready for cooking. But it's no longer permitted to light fires or stoves in the New Forest, so we headed off to the beach, Barton-on-Sea. I found a sheltered spot amongst the rocks. It's not particularly comfortable cooking here, but I set up my little stove. Fried off some lardons and then added a good chunk of butter to the pan and turned off the heat while I added the mushrooms. I just sort of tore them up into pieces, then back on the heat and I fried the mushrooms until they were sizzling and reduced down. So here's the point of this 3/4 pan. All the time that's happening in the main 3/4 pan, 1/4 of the space is available to toast bread on that little perforated griddle. More butter, a bit of flour, and a bit more frying, then milk, and then I simmered this to let it thicken. Then the cheese. I just crumbled this into the sauce and simmered it until it melted in. And lunch is served. Wild mushrooms in a cheesy sauce on toast. Some garlic would have been nice in there, but then again it's really easy to burn garlic with this sort of makeshift cooking setup. And for dessert, we've still got that apple pie, well, 3/4 of a pie. We both had a big chunk of pie with some wobbly, semi-set custard, and there's still some left for later. Superb. And after lunch, we took a nice stroll along the beach. Eva got a chance for her favourite beach activity, which is trying to dig the sand out from under a rock. And that was a lovely day, and I hope you've enjoyed this 3/4-y sort of a video. And if you're one of those 3/4 of a million subscribers, I want to thank you again for that, and thanks for watching. I hope to see you again soon.